Our sermon text this morning comes from Matthew chapter 2, verses 13 through 15. We'll be focusing our attention on that final phrase in verse 15, "Out of Egypt I called my son." So listen carefully as I read, for this is the very word of God. "Now when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, 'Rise, take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt, and remain there until I tell you, for Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him.' And he rose and took the child and his mother by night and departed to Egypt, and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet, 'Out of Egypt I called my son.'" May the Lord bless to our hearts and minds the reading of his word, and you may be seated. I ask that you would please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we praise you for your word. It has great simplicity that even a child can grasp, and great profundity that even years of wrestling by the most learned scholars still leave us humbled before your grandeur. We pray that this morning, by the power of the Spirit, you would enable us to taste both that simplicity and that profundity, and to give glory to Christ. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, no matter how pious or impious we are, whether we are religious or not religious at all of us walk by faith and not by sight. That's right, we all walk by faith and not by sight, because you see, none of us know everything that's going on in the world. None of us have been everywhere. None of us have lived and seen history play out from the times before we were born. Now, as a simple result of our finitude, in order to function in this world, all of us have to take a great deal of information by faith. Every day, throughout the day, and at the end of the day, we are constantly trusting that someone else's word is true and dependable. And when there are competing truth claims, when there are competing words, we have to do our best to try to determine whose word is more faithful, whose account is more trustworthy, who is more likely to be telling the truth. Part of what makes our current world so difficult to live in is that there are so many competing voices, so many truth claims, so many words that we have to consider. In many cases, take our current political situation, for instance, it seems that people aren't just offering different interpretations of the same body of commonly held facts, but rather people are presenting to us distinct alternative realities. And we are constantly having to wrestle with the question, whose word are we to believe? Well, nowhere, of course, does the reality and the necessity of faith, nowhere is that more important than in the area of religion. Because almost all religions make claims about reality and claims about history that we cannot directly verify with our own experience. We cannot travel through time and space and play back the tape of history before our own eyes so that we can personally observe how things really went. At some level, we have to take people's word for it. We have to evaluate the trustworthiness of various truth claims. And we must establish reasons to believe this source over this source. And then we entrust ourselves to those who we deem most reliable. But part of what I want us to see this morning from the very outset is that this is true in religion. But this is true whether we choose to be religious or not. At some level, we all walk by faith in various sources, various words. The issue is not whether we will believe. but simply who and what we will believe. Well, the writers of Scripture, they knew this dynamic very well. They knew that they were making claims about reality, claims about the past, claims about the present, claims about the future that had to be taken on faith. And throughout the Scripture then, we see the writers of the Bible calling for faith in their words. But it's not a blind faith. No, they seek to give us reasons to believe, reasons to depend on their words. Now, at times, the writers of Scripture, they appeal to their own eyewitness testimony about what they have seen and beheld. At other times, they make claims that they are speaking on behalf of God. Consider the Apostle Peter, who does both. He says in 2 Peter 1, "For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. We ourselves heard this very voice born from heaven, and we were with him on the holy mountain." And he then adds, "We have something more sure, the prophetic word, which you will do well to pay attention to, knowing this first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. For no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit." See, the writers of Scripture call for your faith on the basis of their own eyewitness, of their own testimony of what they have seen and heard, and on their claim that they are inspired by the very Holy Spirit of God. They claim to speak on God's behalf. But we say to ourselves, but that's a bold claim. How can one believe it? How can one trust in this sure prophetic word? Well, when it comes to the Scriptures, there are three things that are regularly presented in the Scripture as supporting evidence for these kinds of prophetic claims. One is the presence of accompanying supernatural signs. A supernatural sign is often given. A miracle is performed by the speaker in order to verify or prove the speaker's divine authority. We see this with many of the Old Testament prophets. And in fact, Jesus himself says on many occasions, "If you will not believe me on account of my words, then believe me on account of my works." See, Jesus performed many signs, many miracles in the sight of people in order that people would believe his words and ultimately believe in him. A second major piece of supporting evidence for an authoritative prophetic claim is that the claim came true. When a prophet spoke about a future event, people were encouraged by the Scriptures to hold up that prophetic claim in light of actual events. Did the claim come true? Moses says in Deuteronomy 18, 21 and following, "And if you say in your heart, how may we know the word that the Lord has not spoken?" That is, how do we adjudicate between people who claim to speak for God? How do we know the real word from the false word? Moses goes on to say, "When a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord, if the word does not come to pass or come true, that is a word that the Lord has not spoken. The prophet has spoken presumptuously. You need not be afraid of him." Now it must be said, sometimes the biblical prophets would speak about events in the distant future, events that would not come to pass until well beyond the lifetime of the original hearers. But almost always, those distant claims are connected to more immediate claims about the near future. And as those immediate claims were verified, as they came true, one was given reason to believe the claims that were further off, that those more distant claims would also come true in the same way. And the last means that's given to verify the legitimacy of a prophetic claim is its consistency with the previous claims of true prophets. See, Scripture claims that the truth of God's revelation, it ultimately speaks with one voice, God's voice. So one is to test claims against Scripture. One is to evaluate the teaching and the claim of prophetic authority in light of how well it lines up with previously established claims. One must test the spirits, as the Scripture says. We see this, Jesus doing this to himself. In Luke 24, he shows how his own teaching and his own claims fulfill and line up with the necessary claims of the Old Testament Scriptures. We see the Apostle Paul doing this, where he calls for and then praises this kind of scriptural evaluation of his own preaching. In Acts 17, we read about the Bereans who heard Paul's preaching, and then the text says they searched the Scriptures to see if these things were so, and Paul calls them noble for this labor of prophetic verification, where they tested prophetic claims against the already established claims of Scripture. So we see that there are these tests taken together, and they give us sound reasons to believe in the authority of prophetic biblical testimony. This is a foundation then for moving into our text this morning. You may remember before Christmas, and then before I was sidelined for a few weeks with COVID, we've been taking a look at Matthew's use of the Old Testament as he seeks to lay out and demonstrate that the birth and early life of Christ fulfills Old Testament prophetic witness. We've been looking at Matthew's claims that various aspects of the birth of Christ fulfill Old Testament prophecies about the coming of the Christ. And so a number of weeks ago, we saw how Jesus' conception in the womb of the Virgin Mary, it fulfilled Isaiah's prophecy that the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and you shall call his name Emmanuel. Then we saw how Jesus' birth in Bethlehem fulfilled Micah's prophecy that the Christ, the shepherd, the great ruler of God's people, would in fact be born in Bethlehem. Now we turn to Matthew's quotation of Hosea 11:1. Matthew here argues that when Joseph and Mary and Jesus made their flight to Egypt to escape the violent search of Herod, and then returned from Egypt after Herod had died, that fulfilled what was spoken by the prophet Hosea, "Out of Egypt I called my son." Now on the surface, we might say, well, this is just like the previous passages, right? Where Matthew kind of quotes an Old Testament verse and says that is fulfilled in Jesus. But upon a closer look, this one's a little different. This passage here warrants a different kind of examination as we explore perhaps a different method of understanding prophetic texts. This is because while Isaiah 7:14 and Micah 5:2 were clearly prophesying a future event, which Matthew says is fulfilled in Jesus, Hosea 11:1 doesn't seem to be prophesying a future event at all. In fact, when we look at Hosea 11:1, it reads in full, "When Israel was a child, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son." And then the verse continues, "And the more they were called, the more they went away. They kept sacrificing to the Baals and burning offerings to idols." Now, any reader of Hosea 11:1 can see that when Hosea speaks about my son in verse 1, he is clearly speaking about the nation of Israel as a whole. And when he speaks about calling his son out of Egypt in that same verse, he is not prophesying, it doesn't seem, about some future event, but he is clearly speaking about the past historical event of the Exodus, in which God brought his people out of Egypt through the Red Sea, and after which, Hosea points out, Israel fell away from following the Lord, and they engaged in idolatry with the Baals, which were foreign gods. So the question here is, how can Matthew possibly claim that Jesus being brought out of Egypt as a young boy, how can this possibly fulfill the words of the prophet Hosea when Hosea's words don't seem to be a future-looking prophecy at all? Well, many scholars, even scholars at conservative Christian colleges and evangelical seminaries, have argued it doesn't. In fact, many charge Matthew with taking Hosea 11:1 wildly out of context, making it say something it clearly does not say. There is no prophecy here, they argue, so there cannot be a fulfillment. Matthew, they say, is just making up a textual claim. He's making up a fulfillment that simply is not there. Now, if that is true, then that is a serious charge against Matthew's integrity. I mean, by the time it's all said and done, and we've read all of Matthew's gospel, Matthew is going to make some dramatic claims about Jesus of Nazareth. He's going to call us to believe in Jesus as the Christ, the eternal King who's risen from the dead and who ushers in the kingdom of God. Which raises the question, is Matthew trustworthy? Are his claims true? And if he has blatantly discredited himself in the opening chapters, making a claim about Jesus that is at best ignorant of the Old Testament and is at worst downright deceptive, why should we believe him as he continues to make claims about Jesus throughout this book? I think that's worth discussing. And in the name of rational inquiry, I'm going to ask you to consider what I believe is a reasonable possibility: that Matthew is not an imbecile. Most scholars will acknowledge that Matthew was a Jew and that he was writing his gospel to a primarily Jewish audience in order to prove that Jesus of Nazareth was the Jewish Messiah, the one who fills all the Old Testament promises. And let us assume, I think it is reasonable to do so, that Matthew knew the context of Hosea 11:1. And what is more, let us assume for a moment that Matthew knew his readers knew the context of Hosea 11:1. Because again, Matthew's primary audience was not 21st century Americans, who you could safely assume have never opened the book of Hosea. No, rather, his audience was first century Jews, many of whom had spent their lives reading and listening to the Old Testament, having the Old Testament read to them, taught, sung. Many of Matthew's audience would have immediately caught the Hosea 11:1 reference. And those who did not catch it immediately would have had the ability to go and hear and read it in its context. And it seems reasonable to assume Matthew would have known this, which leaves us with just a couple choices, right? On the one hand, we can conclude Matthew must be an imbecile, or at least a cheap charlatan, right? Who's making a foolish claim that is easily disproven even before his main argument gets going. Or on the other hand, maybe Matthew knows something that some of us don't know. Maybe Matthew is aware of a larger pattern of biblical interpretation within which his claim of Jesus fulfilling Hosea 11:1 is a serious claim, filled with weight, intellectual gravitas, a claim that must be taken seriously by any serious reader of the biblical text. Well, let's explore that second option. We ask the question, well, if that is the case, what would this pattern of interpretation involve? Well, we have to do a little digging here, a little heavy lifting, if you will, but I think it will be worth it in the end. The first thing that we would have to know is we would have to have knowledge of Hosea's historical setting. And then second, we would have to have some knowledge of Hosea's use of language, the theological argument that Hosea is making, and the ultimate prophetic claims that he is offering in his work. Let's consider each of these briefly. First, a brief word on Hosea's context. Some of you will remember this because it wasn't long ago that we studied the book of Hosea as a church. Hosea is writing during the final years of the northern kingdom of Israel. He's writing to an apostate people who have turned from the Lord in almost every conceivable way. And as a consequence of their idolatry and their immorality, the kingdom of Israel was in a great state of internal decay, and it was politically weak and vulnerable. Israel found herself caught between the great political powers of the day, Egypt on one side, Assyria on the other. And throughout the book of Hosea, we see that they are faced with a choice. Who will they turn to for protection, for support, for aid? Hosea is calling them to turn to the Lord, to not put their trust in hostile foreign armies and kings, but rather to return to the Lord in repentance and faith. So this is the context of Hosea's ministry. Now, let's consider a little bit of Hosea's use of language within this context, the theological argument he makes and the prophetic claims he lays on the people. Now, it's clear throughout the book of Hosea that Hosea speaks of Egypt in two senses. On the one hand, he speaks of Egypt as a concrete, actual national political entity who is a major player in Israel's history and in their current situation. Hosea speaks of Egypt this way when he talks about Egypt's role in Israel's history, that at one point Israel was enslaved in actual Egypt, and God delivered them out of actual Egypt in the great act of the Exodus. Hosea also speaks of Egypt this way when he talks about Egypt's role in Israel's present. He identifies that they're an actual country, an empire that poses a political option for Israel in their current circumstances. Israel was deliberating whether they should enter into an alliance with Egypt in order to find protection against Assyria. And with respect to Egypt, as a concrete political entity, Hosea makes prophetic claims in this book. Later in chapter 11, in 11:5, Hosea prophesies that Israel will not return to the land of Egypt. They will not go back to that literal political entity, but rather Assyria shall be their king. So Hosea makes concrete historical prophecies about Israel's immediate future. He tells Israel, Egypt will not protect you, and you should not return there, and in the end, you will not go there, for Assyria will conquer you and rule over you. Those were prophecies that came true. However, it's also important to see that throughout the very same book, Hosea often speaks of Egypt, not as a concrete historical political reality, but as a spiritual state of being. For Hosea, Israel's historical period of slavery in actual Egypt, which the Lord brought them out of in real space and time, that becomes a spiritual metaphor, if you will, where Egypt comes to represent bondage, slavery, physical and spiritual captivity in the hands of another. So throughout the book of Hosea, while Hosea is telling Israel they will not literally return to Egypt, he tells them again and again that spiritually, metaphorically, they will return to Egypt. That is, their kingdom will fall. They will be taken into captivity and exile. They will be ruled and enslaved by another. It just so happens that it will be Assyria that will do this and not Egypt. So, this is a little bit confusing, but I think it helps us make sense of it all. Hosea tells us in Hosea 8:13, Hosea 9:3, Hosea 9:6, that because of their sin, he says these exact words, Israel will return to Egypt. Even though he says in 11:5, they will not return to Egypt, but be taken to Assyria. Hosea's point is that Israel is going to spiritual Egypt. They are going to go into captivity, bondage, slavery, by being taken literally to Assyria. In fact, Hosea 9:3 actually combines these images in the same verse. Hosea writes, "Israel shall not remain in the land of the Lord, but they shall return to Egypt. They shall eat unclean food in Assyria." So it's important for us to see that for Hosea, Egypt is both a literal historical kingdom and a spiritual state of being. And speaking of Egypt in this way, Hosea is standing actually in the prophetic line of Moses himself, who in Deuteronomy 28 warns Israel that if they do not obey the Lord, they will be exiled from the land. And then he says what seems to be competing things. He says they will be scattered among the nations, and they will be taken in ships to Egypt. It seems that what Moses is doing is talking not only about Egypt as historical reality, but as a spiritual state, that when you are scattered to the nations in exile, you are going to Egypt. And this dynamic then sets up another aspect of Hosea's prophecies about the people of Israel. You see, Hosea prophesies that Israel is going to be taken to spiritual Egypt by being dragged off to Assyria. This came true. However, Hosea goes on to say, out of his great love for his people, the day will come when the Lord will call Israel out of bondage. In fact, later in chapter 11, Hosea writes, "The Lord will roar like a lion, and when he roars, his children shall come trembling from the west. They shall come trembling like birds from Egypt and like doves from the land of Assyria, and I will return them to their homes, declares the Lord." So what the Lord is promising throughout the book of Hosea is that he is going to send his people off to exile, spiritual Egypt, literal Assyria. But the day is coming when he is going to engage in what you might call a second exodus, where he will call his people, he will call his son home to himself, he will call them out of exile, out of slavery, out of bondage, and return them to their promised land, the promised state of blessing and communion with the Lord. And so what we see is as the Old Testament moves forward, this longing for an ultimate spiritual exodus grows in the people of God. And it continues to be the hope of the people of God, not only after they are overrun by Assyria, which does happen, but then also after they're taken captivity into Babylon, which happens later. And even after some of God's people return to the promised land after the Babylonian exile, they continue to long for an ultimate exodus from foreign rule, from bondage, and from captivity to sin. And what we see throughout in the coming centuries is throughout the reign of the Assyrians and the Babylonians and the Persians and the Greeks and the Romans, the people of God continue to long for that ultimate roar of God that will call his people home and bring about a spiritual exodus where they will all be called out of spiritual Egypt wherever they find themselves. And that is what Hosea prophesied in Hosea 11. And that is what God's people were longing for. That just as God had done in calling his people out of literal Egypt in the Exodus, so too, once again, would he call his people out of spiritual Egypt and their bondage to the nations and call them to himself. That once again, God's people would be able to say, out of Egypt, the Lord has called his son. Now, to go along with this, the Old Testament also speaks in many places of a singular royal individual who, as renowned scholar Dick Gaffin says, is the chosen son, set apart from the rest of the nation of Israel, yet functioning in solidarity with it. This chosen son, in various passages, represents the nation of Israel as the singular embodiment of the faithful remnant, and then as an individual acts on behalf of the entire nation. His faithfulness is their faithfulness. His salvation is their salvation. And we see this royal son language in many psalms, Psalm 2, Psalm 80, Psalm 89, just to name a few. And we see this idea of a singular individual who represents and then acts on behalf of the entire people of God. We see this very prominently in the prophet Isaiah, who was a rough contemporary of Hosea's. And we especially see this in Isaiah's servant songs, which Dr. Wynn actually has been preaching on here at Westminster over the last couple of months. And what this means, when we take all of this together, is that Hosea and the other Old Testament writers are promising God's people an ultimate spiritual exodus, an ultimate salvation of the beloved Son, who is the nation of Israel, but it will come about through the beloved Son, the singular individual who acts on behalf of the people, where the nation's spiritual fate will be embodied in the dramatic experience of a singular individual who is the servant of the Lord, the royal Son. This is the Old Testament expectation and longing that is weighing on the people of God as the New Testament opens. So what that means is when baby Jesus, whom Matthew has already claimed is the virgin-born Emmanuel, and is the great shepherd ruler who is born in Bethlehem, when this baby Jesus returns from his multi-year stay in Egypt and he re-enters the land of Israel, Matthew says, this is fulfilling Hosea's prophecy. And Matthew's claim is not just that this one simple event kind of fulfills one proof text verse, but rather he's making a much larger claim that this act of coming out of Egypt, in this, Jesus is revealing himself to be in his very person the fulfillment of Hosea's entire prophetic message. Jesus marks the coming spiritual exodus of the people of God from bondage to sin and captivity. And Matthew goes on, not coincidentally, to present Jesus' life as a kind of recapitulation of the entirety of Israel's story. For Jesus experiences a literal exodus out of Egypt. And then, like the people of God, he is tempted in the wilderness, yet without sin. And there he gives his own law in the Sermon on the Mount, which he then fulfills to perfection. And then, in perfect obedience, Jesus offers himself as an atoning death for the sin of the people. And then he is gloriously raised from the dead, in which he provides salvation to all of God's people. And then at Pentecost and beyond, you might say, the Lion of Judah roars and calls his people from all nations home to himself. And now he is preparing a spiritual home for all who believe in Christ. A new heavens and a new earth, a new Jerusalem that all who believe in Christ will dwell in forever. And so you see, far from being a foolish, ignorant, manipulative misuse of Hosea's text, Matthew is rightly showing us that Jesus is the fulfillment of all of Hosea's words and all of Hosea's ultimate longings. Far from taking an isolated verse out of context and making a simple but not altogether helpful point that Hosea would be utterly confused by, Matthew is making a bold, exegetically sound claim that Jesus is the fulfillment of the entire message of Hosea. And I have no doubt that Hosea would hear Matthew's preaching and say, amen, that's it, that's what I was saying. For Jesus is the prophetic fulfillment of the ages. As the beloved Son of the Father, he experiences a literal exodus from actual Egypt so that he can lead all who believe in a grand spiritual exodus out of sin, death, and judgment into the promised land of God's joy and presence for all eternity. And so, brothers and sisters, I want to commend to you Matthew's gospel. I want to commend it to you as a trustworthy word concerning the Lord Jesus Christ. It is a word that fulfills and fully aligns with the previous word of the established prophets. It is a word that presents Jesus Christ as the divine Son and the Savior of the nations. And in Matthew's gospel, Jesus himself offers words of salvation accompanied by miraculous signs, which include Jesus' own prediction of his death and resurrection, and that word came true. Which means that in a world full of lies and manipulation and error and ignorance, in a world where you turn on the TV and you say again and again, I don't know who to believe. In such a world, this is a word that you can believe in. This is a word that you can stake your life on. And this is a word that you can live by. This is a word that on this solid rock you can stand even when all other ground is sinking sand. And I tell you, in the year to come, in 2021, come what may, we can believe and be rooted and grounded in this faithful word, in this faithful Savior. This testifies with one voice, Old Testament and New Testament, giving glory to the Lord Jesus Christ. And may we believe and walk by faith in the year to come. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you and we praise you for your holy, inspired, and inerrant word. We thank you for its simplicity that even a child can understand and believe. And we thank you for its depth that even when we have wrestled with it, given it all our intellectual energy, it still, Lord, leaves us with questions and depth and profundity that we have not exhausted. But we pray you would give us faith to believe and to walk by faith in your word and your Son in the year to come. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.